If you're out in the foyer, come on in. Everybody's excited that the espresso machine is back and they're huddling around the coffee bar. So come on in, come and join us. We're gonna start and worship here in a minute. If you have kids, just a reminder that we do have Kids City downstairs. It starts from the beginning. If you go down the stairs, you'll see the entrance to Kids City. That's from the ages of preschool up to grade 5. There's also a nursery down there for babies. And if you're visiting with us this morning, it's awesome to have you. I just want to say welcome. My name is Pastor Matt. It's great to have you here and join us. I pray that you have an encouraging experience here at Gateway, and we'd love to be able to hear from you. We'd love to be able, if you're able to fill out a guest card either in the seat in front of you or out at the connection booth, we'd love to be able to get in contact with you and send you a gift as well. Every Sunday we start off with a word of Scripture. We read from the Bible, and this morning I want to read to you from Philippians 2. This is the passage that we're going to be preaching from this morning. It's Philippians 2, verses 12 to 30. It says this: "Dear friends, you always followed my instructions when I was with you. And now that I'm away, it is even more important. Work hard to show the results of your salvation, obeying God with deep reverence and fear. For God is working in you, giving you the desire and the power to do what pleases Him. Do everything without complaining and arguing so that no one can criticize you. Live clean, innocent lives as children of God, shining like bright lights in a world full of crooked and perverse people. Hold firmly to the word of life. Then on the day of Christ's return, I'll be proud that I did not run the race in vain, and that my work was not useless. But I'll rejoice even if I lose my life, pouring it out like a liquid offering to God, just like your faithful service is an offering to God. I want all of you to share that joy. Yes, you should rejoice, and I will share your joy. If the Lord is willing, I hope to send Timothy to you soon for a visit. Then he can cheer me up by telling me how you are getting along. I have no one else like Timothy who genuinely cares about your welfare. And all the others care only for themselves and not for what matters to Jesus Christ. But you know how Timothy has proved himself like a son with his father. He has served with me in preaching the good news. Hope to send him to you just as soon as I find out what is going to happen to me here. And I have confidence from the Lord that I myself will come to see you soon. Meanwhile, I thought I should send Epaphroditus back to you. He is a true brother, co-worker, and fellow soldier. He was your messenger to help me in my need. I'm sending him because he is longing to see you. He was very distressed that you heard he was ill. And he certainly was ill. In fact, he almost died, but God had mercy on him and also on me so that I would not have one sorrow after another. So I'm all the more anxious to send him back to you, for I know you'll be glad to see him, and then I will not be so worried about you. Welcome him in the Lord's love, and with great joy, and give him the honor that people like him deserve, for he risked his life for the work of Christ. And he was at the point of death while doing for me what you couldn't do from far away." Amen. I'm going to read to you a prayer, and I'd love for you to be able to join with me. You may be able to say it out loud or just try to absorb the message of this prayer. It's from Marjorie Kempe, and it's from the 1300s, so this is several hundred years old. It's amazing to be able to read a prayer, someone who's followed and chosen to follow Jesus in a lineage of following Jesus just like us. Let's read this together. It says, "Lord, you say that no man may be drawn to you unless you draw him. Therefore, Lord, I pray that you will draw all people to you, regardless of how sinful they are. I never deserved to be drawn to you, Lord, and yet, in your great mercy, you drew me. If people around me knew my great wickedness as you do, they would marvel at the great goodness you've shown to me. If you can make such an unworthy creature as me worthy to be your servant, then you can turn the lowest sinner into the highest saint. I beg that you will turn all sinners into saints. Amen. Dear Heavenly Father, as we gather here, Lord, I pray that our greatest desire within our heart is that we would become saints, that you'd change our hearts. God, that you'd turn a heart of stone into a heart of flesh. And Jesus, that our desire would be to come and to be with you. Lord, we are here for you today. We're here for you, dear Jesus. God, would you make yourself known to us? In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Won't you stand with us as we worship? I encourage you to take part with us as we worship the Lord in song.
Set free. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Sing that again.
It's amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you laid down your life, that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. And worthy is the Lord slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King. Who conquered the grave.
Come on, let's sing it out this morning.
Worthy is the Lamb was slain.
Come on.
Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, 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 Lord. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. Done for me.
As we continue in worship, Judy wants to share something with you that's on her heart from this Holy Spirit, I believe.
Yeah, it is. Sometimes I know the Lord wants me to speak, but other times there's a pounding in my heart. And I know this word is for somebody here, maybe more than one. I don't know if you're aware, but the schools in the school district have these shutters on the windows. And when there's a threat outside, in moments, these shutters drop. And it blocks the threat from what's inside the classroom. And there's no light that gets through. And then God was saying to me today that some of you, and me too, have put up shutters in our hearts. Things that have been said to us or done to us that have hurt us. And we put up these shutters as a protection against that pain and against that threat. And God, the light of God can't penetrate a heart like that. Because as soon as we begin to protect ourselves, we build up walls or shutters of unforgiveness, revenge, building up arguments of how we were right. Anger, unforgiveness. And the Lord can't use a shattered heart. And he spoke so clearly to me this morning, and he said, you must forgive those who have hurt you. You've got to let the shutters come down so the light can come in. Let the offenses go. He wants today, even as we've got some more songs of worship, to take some quiet time and surrender the issues, the pain, the offense, and just give it to the Lord. He wants you to surrender that so the light can come in and all of heaven can, all of heaven's blessings can come into your life and release you. Matthew 11:28 says, come unto me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. God wants to do that today as you surrender. So I don't even know what to suggest here. We do have prayer at the back if you need somebody to pray with you. But even during this time, if you can just get honest with yourself, let the Lord stir in your heart and show you things that you need to put on the floor and say, God, you can have these in these next few songs.
Thank you so much.
Stars, they wept. The morning sun was dead. The Savior of the world was fallen. His body on the cross, his blood poured out for us, the weight of every curse upon him. Breath you gave as heaven looked away, the Son of God was laid in darkness. A battle in the grave, the war on death was waged, the power of hell forever broken. The ground began to shake, the stone was rolled away, his perfect love could not be overcome. Now death, where is your sting? Our resurrected King has rendered you defeated. Forever he is glorious. Thank you. has overcome. We sing hallelujah. Yes, we sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome. Yes, we sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah. Yes, we sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome. Yes, we sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah. Forever He is glorified, forever He is lifted high, forever He is risen, He is alive, He is alive. We sing. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb is overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. Forever He is glorified.
For the cross and my King. I sing praises to your name. Praises to your name. The name that's so much higher than all names. All honor to your name. All honor to your name. The name that's so much greater than all names. Be lifted.
Always finds me. You always find me.
a love that always finds me right where I am. Your name, your name.
Exalt him higher than anything, higher than any struggle, higher than any sorrow. Lift him higher. He's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He's your comforter. He's your best friend. He's your provider. He's your protector. Be lifted up. Let our praises rise. This we know is true. You're good, you're good. You're good, you're good. You're good to us. Oh, let our praises fill the temple. Let our praises fill the temple. Let our praises fill the temple, 'cause you are good. Yes, you are. Yes, you are. Let your glory come. Let your will be done. Let your glory come. Let your will be done. are better, so much better. Your ways are better, so much better. Your ways are better. Your ways are better. Every corner of my heart, take your place in every part. Have your way, your ways have never failed me. Every corner of my heart, take your place in every part. Have your way, your ways have never failed me. Every corner. Take your place in every part. Have your way, your ways have never failed me. Though it cost me everything, I'll still follow where you lead. 'Cause you are good, you are good to us. You are good. You are good to us. You are good. You are good to us.
Sing that song, Be Lifted Up. We're singing this song about God, Jesus being lifted up. And he's lifted up through your lives. That's how he lifted up. You are God's image bearer. You are his representative. And he's lifted up through the living out of your life, through the things that come out of your mouth. He's lifted up through you. This morning when we're praying before the service, Buck had a scripture that you shared that I actually really felt was for today. You know, it's that scripture where Jesus is telling a parable of two people that are building a house. You know, when one builds their house on a sand and the other builds their house on a rock, and the storms come. And we kind of been having a storm, right? It's crazy windy out there. If you don't have something nailed down, it's flying away, right? The person on the, you know, they build their house on the sand. You know, when the storm comes, it's that house is torn down. It falls down. It can't stand. But the house on the rock stands. And Jesus says, if you build life on me, it'll be able, your life will be able to get through those storms. And I just couldn't get that out of my mind, Buck, that idea of foundation. And just felt like we need to ask you today, is your house, is the life, is the foundation of your life built on Jesus? Because it's not about if, it's a matter of when those storms come. They're going to come. For some of you, the storms are right now. And on the outside, you can have a house that looks really, really good, but the foundation is weak. My wife, Catherine, her dad, he was a farmer, but he also moved houses on the side. So he would come and he would lift houses off their foundation and move them. And there's a period of time, I remember when Catherine's younger brother, he bought a house. And they lived in it for a while, but then they realized the foundation just really wasn't good. And so her dad came in and literally lifted the house up off the foundation. Tore out the foundation and poured a brand new foundation for that house, then put it back down. There's a lot of Christians, and you might be in this boat where it's like, it looks right on the outside. Your house looks good, but your foundation isn't good. When you get down to the core of your life, the thing that you're basing your life on. You know, Jesus wants to come in. He's that ultra renovator. He's not going to come in. He's not going to tear your house down. He's not going to rip it all out. What he's going to do, I believe, it's like he wants to come in and he wants to lift you up. And he's going to come and he's going to tear out that faulty foundation that you've created. And he wants to pour you a brand new foundation in Jesus Christ. That's on him. He wants to do that inner work. And when it's all done, it might look the same on the outside, but you are a brand new person in Jesus. So would you open up your heart to that today? As we sing, as we've been singing this song, be lifted up. Be lifted up. Jesus, would you be lifted up in our lives? And Lord, if we have cracks in our foundation, if we have a faulty foundation, Lord, we give you the permission to come in, to lift us up, tear out that junky foundation, and lay something brand new in you. Jesus, lay that foundation. It's going to be in you. It's going to be on the solid rock of Jesus Christ. And as you do that, we're going to be stronger than ever. And the storms of life are going to come. And no matter how hard those storms come, we're going to stay strong in you, dear Jesus. Because you are our rock. Hallelujah, Lord. Thank you for worshiping with us this morning. We are actually going to go into our 5-minute break right now. And then we're going to have a time of teaching, and then we're going to gather around the Lord's table and have communion together. So as we go into this 5-minute break, carry the presence of Jesus with you. There's someone here that needs a hug from you. And there's some people in this room that are saying, don't touch me. If that's the case, maybe give them a fist bump. I don't know. But say hi to someone. If you need, grab a coffee, go to the bathroom. And we're going to be back here in 5 minutes. If you can throw that timer on. See you in 5. Good morning, Gateway. If you're out in the lobby, come make your way back in. The morning's about to get real awesome, even more awesome than what it's been. It is a good morning. Nobody told me that the wind was going to be this strong when I moved out here a couple months ago. Well, like, I'm used to these winds in the prairies and stuff. Like, we get, like, some strong winds, but not for 3 days. Like, what is going on out here? Normally, it's hot winds we get, too. So, I mean, this is a little bit colder, and, you know, I'll get used to it, but a little warning would have been nice next time. I'm just kidding. I'm loving it out here. We're having a good time. I'm going to bring you some good announcements today. We have some giving options available here. So if you're here looking on how to give, we got a new debit machine. It looks awesome, actually. It's up and running and everything. Or you can give online at gcchurch.ca/giving. You can text the number on the screen or e-transfercandace@gcchurch.ca. Giving is just an amazing way that we get to worship God. He asked for 10% of our income. That's what the Bible says. And it is just such a cool way to see how God works in our lives, especially when we trust Him in our finances and everything like that. And so we got another cool event coming up. Tomorrow we got a trunk or treat event that's going to be running. Super pumped for that. It's going to be awesome. If you have any last minute like candy you want to donate, just drop it off real quick either tomorrow morning, sometime during then. But we're pretty pumped for that. Just going to be an awesome opportunity. Be praying for it because we get to be in the community. And we get to show GC Church that we're open to having people come to the church. We're open to getting to know people, especially in the community around us. And so it's going to be really awesome. Excuse me. And after, we got a parenting workshop coming up. So we have a video to play for that. If we get the video up there, and then we'll be able to get into that.
An upcoming parenting workshop that's happening on Friday, November 4th.
We know firsthand that as parents, we have good intentions for our kids.
Yeah, that's right.
But sometimes in our interactions with discipline, we can find ourselves navigating through chaos and hurt feelings, things said that we wish had been said, and we might wonder about the effectiveness of our discipline strategy.
The Discipline That Connects workshop highlights a framework sharing principles and messages that you can communicate to your kids even when they are misbehaving. It's the opportunity to grow in mentoring your child, empowering them to manage their own behavior, and watch kindness and wisdom grow within your family.
We would love to have you join in for this 2.5-hour workshop. Check out gcchurch.ca for more details and to sign up. And we look forward to meeting you.
Yeah, see you soon.
This is going to be such an amazing opportunity. So this is on November 4th, this coming Friday. You got to sign up for it. It's $20 per couple. There's childcare provided. And I'm not a parent, but I've worked and volunteered with youth for the past 6 years. I've seen what it looks like for youth to not have parents. And they come in and their backgrounds and their history, or a parent or a child who doesn't have a mother, who doesn't have a father, and all these different issues that come with youth. So your role, you don't need me to tell you this, it's so vital in these kids' lives. And especially working with the youth now, I get to see that even more so now. So you guys both inspire me to be a good parent one day, but I also know that there's going to be struggles because just the way the culture's going, we see it everywhere. And so this is such an incredible opportunity that we each get to take to better these kids and better their lives. Like the foundation that Matt was talking about and Buck brought up with the verse, we got to build right foundation in their lives. And it's such a cool opportunity that we get. And this is such a great way to do it. Matt and Josie are going to do such an awesome job teaching us about all of this. And then another amazing opportunity we have coming up is our Refresh Retreat weekend. On Saturday, November 12th. It is going to be amazing. Pastor Mark Lewis is going to be here. And if you don't know him, he's an amazing person. Really fun to be around. So be here just to meet him and stuff. There's lunch and dinner that's included in the cost, which is $20, and it's from 10 a.m. to 9 p.m. You got to sign up for it, and do sign up before November 10th and stuff. This is going to be such a special day. Like, I get we're all busy. We have lives. We got jobs. Some of us have many jobs, and this is a moment where we just get to pause, we get to stop, and we get to say, Jesus, I'm here with you. I'm listening. My soul is hungry for you. I want to experience you. This is the dedication of this day. We want to experience God and help you guys experience Him as well. And so make sure to sign up for that because it gets busy. Life gets busy. And especially now we got Christmas coming up, got the holidays, travel, everything. It's going to get wild. So be there. It's going to be amazing. And with that, I'd like to invite Pastor Mike up, and he's going to bring us the word this morning.
Awesome. Well, good morning again. It's good to be here. I always think, like, sometimes we take church for granted, right? Like, oh, it's Sunday, I gotta get up, I gotta go to church. But, like, we get to be in church. And I think it's such an awesome thing. We have the ability to go to church, and it's so exciting to be here. So as Matt read the scripture this morning, we are in Philippians. We've been going through the book of Philippians for the last few weeks. We get to go through the whole book. So we're in chapter 2 this morning. And in this passage, Paul urges the Philippians to live for Christ, and he again emphasizes his close personal relationship with the Philippian church. So just before we get into it, just before we get into the scripture this morning, I want to just pause and do something maybe a little bit different. I was thinking about this, and some of you are parents, some of you are not, but you know, if you've ever worked with kids, if you've spent time with kids, our kids are young, they're 5 and 3 right now, and they just have that wonder and excitement about life and the world. They're just curious about things. And so our son Ian, one thing he's been curious about lately is tires on vehicles. He goes around looking at them. He's like, hey, this vehicle has tires. It has 4 tires. Like, yes. And then recently he discovered spare tires. So this was even more exciting. So there wasn't just the 4 that are touching the ground. Most vehicles have a spare tire. So now he's curious about if the vehicle has a spare tire. So we have to go looking. We have a truck, so it's underneath at the back. So he goes looking and checking vehicles to see if they have spare tires. And he's like, Dad, come on, let's go look for a spare tire. And he's just so curious about this. So I was thinking about this and our walk with God and how we can be curious about what Jesus is doing in our lives. So just for a second, I want you to close your eyes and just imagine that you're a kid. You're young. You know, however old it is, 5, 10, and you're walking along, and this is your own life, but what's going on in your life right now? What's something that you're curious about? And just imagine this. Put that question in your mind, something you're asking Jesus, whatever that is for you personally. You're thinking about that question. Jesus comes up beside you as an adult, you're a kid, and he puts his hand out to you. You reach up to him, and you hold his hand. And you're like, Jesus, I'm wondering about this. And Jesus looks at you as a parent would look at their child, loving. He's excited to see you. And he says, put your own name in here. Mike, let's go check that out. Let's find out about that. Let's see what that looks like. Let's discover that together. And you walk with Jesus, and he talks to you, and you explore that question together. And Lord, I pray as we look at your word this morning, that our hearts would be open to you, that we would be curious about what you're doing, that we see walking together with you as something exciting. We get to discover this adventure called life with you. We get to be with you. You walk alongside us. We pray as we look at your word this morning that you would just bring it into our hearts and our minds, that we would be open to what you're speaking, even as Judy spoke this morning, that we would be willing to lower our shutters, that we would be willing to open our hearts and our souls to what you are speaking and to the people around us. We pray this in your name. Amen. So we're looking at Philippians chapter 2. And the reason I say that is because, you know, sometimes you're preaching, someone will come up to you after the service and like, great sermon. I really liked the part where you talked about, and in my head I'm thinking, I didn't say that. I never said that at all. And that's because the Holy Spirit is speaking. And that happens more than you would think. And like, you put your sermon together and you have these ideas and you have your points and all of this, and people come up to you and are talking about the sermon. And you're like, I didn't say any of that, I don't think. But the Holy Spirit did. And the Holy Spirit speaks to people. And it's amazing what people get out of church that, you know, maybe we didn't even say because the Holy Spirit was speaking. And that's why church works, is because of the Holy Spirit. So as we look at this passage, Paul is urging the Philippians to continue to live out their salvation. We know from the past couple of messages that at this time, Paul is in jail. He is not physically present with the Philippians. He has been there a number of times. He has spent time with them, but he is not present at the moment. So he is telling them, you know, even though I'm not there, even though I'm not physically with you at this time, to continue to work out your salvation, continue to live for Christ. Even though I'm not with you, continue living the same as if I was with you. Because though Paul set an example for them and taught them, he can't be everywhere all the time. There was many churches, there was many places. Paul wrote, he visited, he traveled a lot, but he couldn't be physically present at all of the churches. But the Holy Spirit was. And so they could continue to live out their salvation even though Paul wasn't physically present with them. And he's reminding of this, continue to live out your salvation even though I'm not there with you right now. And it's in this context of living out their salvation, this context of obedience, that Paul begins to address some issues that were happening in the local church in Philippi. And I think something that struck me as I was working through this passage is, in our North American minds, our Canadian minds, we've been talking about this a lot, and Pastor Matt has done a great job of illuminating some of how our Canadian culture limits our thinking. And even when we go to the Bible, we are interpreting the Bible through the lens of our own worldview, our opinions, the way culture has shaped us. And we're seeing the Bible in a Canadian way, where other people from other cultures will see different things in the Bible. They'll see it differently just because of our differences in culture, the way that we were raised. And something about salvation struck me in that we often think that salvation is an individual choice that's between me and God, something that we do, and there's this point in time where I wasn't a Christian, and now I am a Christian, and I prayed a certain prayer, and now I'm a Christian. That's kind of our stereotype of becoming a Christian, right? And that happens. There sometimes is that very clear point and moment where you weren't a Christian and then you were. But probably for more people than that, salvation is a process. It happens over time where at some point in your life you weren't a Christian and then at some point you were. And you don't exactly know when that happened, but at some point you went from not believing to believing. And between that, there was all kinds of things that happened, probably questions and discussions and conversations and reading the Bible and going to church and talking with people, but it happened over time. It was a process. And I think salvation is a lot less linear than we tend to think it is, and it's also much less individual than we tend to think it is. And that's what Paul's talking about in this passage. When he says, work out your salvation, he's not so much saying, like, Judy, work out your salvation, although he is saying that. He's saying, church, body of Christ, work out your salvation. He's talking about salvation in the context of the community, in the context of the whole church. He's not pointing so much at individual people. He's pointing at the gathering of the body of Christ. And he's saying that there were some issues going on in the church. There were some arguments, there were some dissensions, there were some tensions in relationships. And he's saying, church, work out your salvation. Work out your issues. Deal with these problems because salvation is part of the body of Christ. It's not individuals here and individuals there and this person and that person. You're all in this together. You need to work out your salvation, meaning the whole church, the whole body of Christ. And salvation is not so much individual, but salvation is lived and worked out in the community. And again, even when people become Christians, it's very rare that someone comes to Christ on their own. It happens. You hear stories in the Middle East, people had dreams and visions, and they come to Christ, essentially on their own. Jesus directly speaks to them, and that certainly happens, but probably not that often. It's more common that people come to Christ in community. And you can probably look at your own story and think, did you come to Christ alone, by yourself? Probably not. It was probably someone in your family. It was probably a close friend. It was maybe a coworker, someone that you had a relationship with that walked with you as you came to Christ. It almost certainly was in the context of community and relationships that you came to know Christ. And again, that's what Paul is talking about here, the community, that salvation is corporate rather than individual. And in the light of this view on salvation, where we, again, look away from the individual and to the community, Paul is talking to them about the issues that were going on in the church, and he's urging them to live in harmony with each other. He's urging them to get along, to work out their differences, again, to work out their salvation together in the context of the community. And we all know the last couple of years that we've lived through, you know, who hasn't been part of some sort of argument, right? Whatever it is, you know, you name it, politics, faith, community, healthcare, whatever it is, you've probably been part of some sort of argument or discussion on those topics, because we have different opinions, we have different experiences, we have different ideas, we have different beliefs on the things that go on around us, right? And I don't know what exactly was going on in the Philippian church, but it seems there was some sort of arguments and dissensions and a lack of harmony going on in that church too. So nothing new here, right? 2,000 years ago, churches were having the same issues that we have today. And in the world that we live in a world, especially probably right now, more than at other times in history, we live in a world that's uncertain. We don't know exactly what's going to happen. You know, if you invest and you look at the stock market, the assumption has been often over history, you know, it just goes up, right? Yeah, there's bumps and things, but the stock market just goes up. We're looking at that right now. Not necessarily the case, right? Housing prices, interest rates, it's all over the place. Like, who would have predicted inflation would have been at 9% this year? Who would have predicted that house prices would double, but then, you know, they'd come down and interest rates would go up? And it's just, it's all over the place. We don't know what to think anymore. And the experts who are supposed to know about these things have not made the right predictions, and they don't know, right? We don't know what's going to happen. There's uncertainty in the world. And I think when we're afraid, when we're uncertain, we try to label things or label people. And we come to this place where there's us and there's them, right? You know, there's people that have this political view and there's people that have that political view. And I'm over here, and if you're not with me, you're against me, right? That's been kind of our take on some things over the last few years. And whatever it is, insert, you know, any other number of issues there. There's us and them, and we try and label and describe, because when we're afraid, if we can put a label on something, it makes it easier to explain what is going on. Even if we're wrong, we put that label on, think, well, I've got a label on that, I can explain it, I can describe it, and I don't have to be afraid of something I can describe. But we might be wrong. What if my opinion is different than this opinion, and maybe the answer is somewhere over here, and we're both wrong, right? But we try and label it to make ourselves more comfortable. And this is the key point, and I think what Paul would get at with the Philippian church would be the same, is that we need to realize that we're different. We don't all have the same opinions, beliefs, and backgrounds. And I think looking at the Bible, looking at what Paul says, looking at what Jesus taught, you would see that Paul or Jesus, the Bible would teach that our salvation doesn't come from our politics. It doesn't come from our jobs. It doesn't come from our money. It doesn't come from our houses. It doesn't come from any of those things. It doesn't come through healthcare. It doesn't come through our social perspectives. Salvation doesn't come from any of those things. Salvation comes from Jesus and from him only. And you look at how Jesus lived his life, would you guess that Jesus, you know, if you tried to say, well, Jesus was left wing, right wing, like, would you be able to pin Jesus down? I don't think so, because he had a wide variety of perspectives. He met with all kinds of people. Would you be able to, you know, design like Jesus was this type of politician? I don't think so. You couldn't. It's not that narrow. Jesus came to save, not to rule. And sometimes we get maybe a little sidetracked on some of those things. And in the Philippian church, it seems that there was, you know, whatever they were, there were some of these tensions, these divisions, these arguments, and Paul is urging them to bridge the gap and find healing and relationship, because salvation is lived, it's from Jesus, and it's lived and expressed in community. That's where our salvation is worked out, is in community, in the body of Christ. And I think that's what Paul is saying to the Philippian church. Work out your salvation together. Work it out. Bridge the gaps. Find ways to be in relationship with other believers. Even if you don't agree, find ways to work out your salvation together. And as we've seen over the last couple of years, it sometimes feels almost impossible to bridge the gap, right? People that have different opinions, different ideas than you. And in human terms, it may actually be impossible, but it's not impossible with Jesus. And it's not impossible with the Holy Spirit, because he can bring us together as we allow him to speak to us, and as we walk with Jesus, we are able to come together with the body of Christ, and Jesus helps us to bridge those differences and those gaps as we work out our salvation together. So after talking about kind of these internal concerns in the church, the relationships amongst the body of Christ, Paul starts looking at their external witness, what they do in the community, how they're perceived in the community. And we ask, how is salvation lived out externally? We work out our salvation in the body of Christ, but we also work out our salvation outside of a Sunday morning gathering, right? Because we're here on a Sunday for a couple of hours, and we spend 98% of our week outside of the church. We're at school. We're at our jobs, we're at our houses, we're in our neighborhoods, we're at the grocery store. So to say that we would only work out our salvation on a Sunday morning, maybe sometimes we think that, like, I'll go to church, I'll get what I need, you know, I'll get my couple of hours of Jesus for the week, and I'm good to go. And then we go out, and sometimes maybe we think the rest of our life doesn't matter. But the majority of our life is not lived in church. Fortunately, Jesus goes with us. And that's what Paul is talking about with the Philippians, that they work out their salvation in the context of the body of Christ, but it's worked out in the community very much, the broader community, the people that surround us every day. And Paul says that the Philippians are to shine as lights for the gospel, and they're to shine as lights in a world that is desperate for hope, in a world that is desperate for answers, in a world that we live in today where there aren't a lot of easy answers, there aren't a lot of things that we can just point to and say, that is right. I can tell you what interest rates are going to be in 2 months from now. We don't know, right? It's a world that's uncertain. But there is something that is certain, a person who's certain, and that's Jesus. And in an anxious world, we can go to Jesus and know that there's a foundation. Again, as we talked about this morning, Jesus is a solid foundation to rest upon. The Bible says that Jesus, that God, never changes. Never. Things around us change. They're uncertain. They're unpredictable. God does not change. So if you want something solid that you can rely on that's not going to change, go to Jesus, because he hasn't changed ever, and he's not going to. He's the same. So as we go out in the world, as we're uncertain, as we live in an anxious world, it's easy to be infected by anxiousness, because people around us are anxious, because we don't know what's going to happen. We're uncertain. And it's easy to live in that anxiety. It's not surprising that mental illnesses, anxiety and depression are higher than they've ever been in recent memory. We live in an anxious world. And in this world, it can be easy to fall into, you know, the fight, flight, freeze. You've ever heard of those categories when you're faced with a difficult situation? Some people want to fight. Some people want to flight, just run away. Some people freeze. They don't know what to do. That's not our calling as Christians to take any of those options. We're not necessarily to fight. There's a time and a place to have a discussion, but we're not meant to fight. You know, you look at Jesus. Did he fight people? He had strong words. He had arguments, but usually for the religious leaders, not the political leaders. And you didn't see Jesus fighting. But neither did you see Jesus just running away and camping out with the disciples on a mountain for 5 years. He took time away, but a few hours here and there, a day here and there, and he went right back into the mix. And neither did you see Jesus or the disciples freezing. They never just stood there not knowing what to do. Jesus was guided by the Father, and he knew what to do. He knew what God was speaking to him. So rather than taking those options as Christians, we're to live in the world. We're not to isolate. We're not to fight. We're not to freeze. We're to live in the world, although not as the world, as we read in John. And the reality of our salvation is lived out in the world. That's where we work out our salvation, not just at church, but as we go about our daily lives. We're not to be isolated from the world, shut off and hiding out. We're not to be afraid of the world because Jesus is in control. We're not to fight the world because the gospel is more influential than any argument that we can come up with. We're to live in the world alongside of people sharing the light of Jesus. And you could say, you know, what exactly does that look like? And, you know, we could talk about that. But I think it's better to think of it in your own life. What does that look like as you go out? As you go out today from church, what does it look like to live as a light of Jesus? How does that work in your life? As Jesus is walking with you, because Jesus doesn't stay in church, right? When you go out these doors this morning, Jesus goes with you. And you are a light. And maybe it sounds too simplistic, but just being a Christian, having Jesus in you, when you desire to live for Jesus, it becomes obvious that you are living for Christ. Because you will make different choices than the people around you. You will live differently. You will look different. And people will sense that. People will see that light in you, even if it doesn't necessarily feel to you like it's obvious. To other people, it does become obvious as you are walking with Jesus. If you live for Jesus, you won't help being a light for Jesus. You won't be able to stop it. It will be something that comes out of you. As long as those shutters aren't down, right? The light will be spilling out of you as you go, whatever it is you're doing throughout the week. In this last part of the passage, Paul turns to the reality of his situation, or the middle part, sorry. Whether presently or at some point in the not-too-distant future, Paul realizes he is most likely going to die for the gospel. He doesn't know whether it's going to be soon or whether it's going to be at some point in the future, because as we see in this passage, he hopes to travel to Philippi again. So he doesn't necessarily think he's going to die right now, but he knows that at some point, he is most likely going to be executed for the gospel, and he explains his situation to the Philippians. And it seems strange that he can say that he would rejoice and that even the Philippians can rejoice in Paul's situation. First, that he's in jail, and secondly, that he's pretty certain that he will die for the gospel. And again, it's only in Christ that this makes sense. Because as Matt preached a few weeks ago, the situation for Paul was a win-win. Because whether he died or whether he lived, the kingdom of God moved forward, and God's will was done. It didn't matter so much what happened to Paul specifically. It mattered that either way, God's plans were moving forward, that the kingdom was growing and expanding. And Paul was well aware of the risks he was taking for the gospel, and he knew the likely outcome, yet he continued to press on, and he continued to live for Christ. And the simple fact is that following Jesus is often not easy. And in Mark 16, it says, Jesus says this to the disciples, "If any of you wants to be my follower, you must give up your own way, take up your cross, and follow me. If you try to hang on to your life, you will lose it. But if you give up your life for my sake, you will save it. And what do you benefit if you gain the whole world but lose your soul? Is anything worth more than your soul?" And I think, again, looking at salvation, this is what Paul is saying. Salvation is worth more than anything we can find in the world. This salvation that he has just spoken about, that is lived in the community, that's experienced in the community, that's worked out in the community, it's more valuable than anything else, anything that the world could offer. So Paul is willing to die for this salvation because he hasn't found anything worth more than that. And whatever happens to him, he is confident that he will be with Christ and that God's will be worked out. And he can say again, it's a win-win. It doesn't matter what happens to me. And he urges the Philippians to rejoice in that same attitude because it's the same for them. It doesn't matter what happens to the Philippian church. It doesn't matter what happens to the people in the church living for Christ, living for salvation, living in salvation. Whatever happens, it's a win-win as they live for Christ. And this last part of the passage, you know, it's one of the last few verses here when Paul talks about Timothy and Epaphroditus. It's one of those little sections where it's probably easy to gloss over. We could just kind of move past this. You know, he's talking about his friends, talking about, you know, some trips he's making. But I want to spend just a couple of minutes looking here because Paul's talking about two of his partners in ministry, Timothy and Epaphroditus, who serve as examples of a life of ministry to the gospel and help to facilitate Paul's connection with the Philippian church. So we know probably about Timothy. If you've spent some time reading the New Testament, you've probably heard about Timothy. Paul wrote about him a lot. Timothy has a couple of letters in the New Testament dedicated to him from Paul, as Paul wrote to him. And we know that Paul mentored Timothy, and he was the closest personal relationship that Paul had, that he had raised him. He viewed him like a son. He viewed him like a son in the gospel. And Paul trusts Timothy completely, and he knows that he can rely on him to do whatever is necessary. So because Paul is in prison, he desires to send Timothy to the Philippians in order to share what Paul himself would like to say to the Philippians, but he knows that Timothy is reliable, and whatever Timothy says, they'll be on the same page. They'll be able to communicate the same message. And Paul is relying on Timothy to be a bridge, a connection between himself and the church at Philippi. And he desires to send Timothy to reinforce his close connection and relationship with the Philippian church. And then secondly, Paul refers to Epaphroditus, another link between himself and the Philippian church. So what had happened was the Philippians had sent Epaphroditus to Paul in jail. Again, as Matt preached a few weeks ago, we learned that you were pretty much on your own in a Roman prison. There was no sort of social support system. So people relied upon their friends, their families, their supporters to support them in prison. So the Philippians had sent Epaphroditus to Paul in order to bring that support, in order to bring money, in order to bring food, in order to be, you know, a personal connection for Paul, someone to talk to in this time. And so it was possible that Epaphroditus intended to stay with Paul indefinitely, that he was going to be there, that the Philippians sent him and said, "Okay, Epaphroditus, you go and be with Paul. You are going to be our hands and feet for Paul in this situation, and just stay there. you know, as long as it takes, just stay there, because Paul needed someone, you know, to support him. So Epaphroditus could go to the grocery store, bring Paul food, he could bring him paper, he could bring him writing materials, he could help get Paul's letters sent so that they actually made it where they were supposed to go, because Paul's in prison, right? He can write, but he can't just, you know, send a letter necessarily and hope that it gets where it's going. He needed people to deliver those letters. But we find out that Epaphroditus nearly died of some sort of illness in his mission to go and support Paul. But we find out he didn't die. Paul is grateful that he didn't have to have another sorrowful situation happen in the midst of a difficult, already difficult situation. And it's likely that Epaphroditus probably stayed with Paul for some time. But rather than staying indefinitely, as probably was the original plan, Paul desires to send Epaphroditus back to Philippi. And it's hard to say, like, when we're reading the passage, the way Paul writes, you know, there's some different theories on how to look at this passage and how to interpret it. There's some commentators think that Epaphroditus didn't want to leave. He didn't want to leave Paul because his mission was to stay there to support Paul. So think, if I leave, how is Paul going to get his food? How is he going to get his daily essentials if I'm not there? But Paul desires to send him back, and he honors him for his hard work in the gospel, and it urges the Philippian church to receive him in the same manner. Because again, there's a possibility that, you know, Epaphroditus shows up back in Philippi and the church is like, hey, why are you here? You're supposed to be with Paul. You're supposed to be helping him. We sent you to help him. We sent you to be there. You know, why are you back? You're not supposed to be here. And Paul's saying, no, that's not the case. I'm sending him back. I'm going to be fine here. And I want him to go back to the church to bring you news of me, to build our connection. I want you guys to hear about what's going on here, and I want him to be able to share with you what I've been able to tell you. And it's actually pretty likely that Epaphroditus was carrying this letter that we read today back to the Philippian church, that Paul had taken the time to write the Philippians. Epaphroditus carried this letter back to the Philippian church. Now, I was just thinking, imagine this, that Paul has written them this letter. In those days, you know, there was one copy of the letter. Originally, Paul wrote or had someone write this letter. There's one copy of it. So it wasn't like today where you could email out a copy of this letter to everyone, right? And everyone's got a copy, can send it around. There's one copy. Epaphroditus takes this letter, this scroll, whatever it's written on. He goes to church and he reads the letter. He reads the whole letter to the Philippian church. He's like, okay, guys, I'm back. I've got a letter from Paul. Let's hear what it says. And it's read. The same letter that we read today was written to the church. Imagine being in the service that day where you don't know. Like, there's no Facebook updates. There's no, Paul's not sitting in jail with his smartphone tweeting about what's happening. Like, oh, guys, saw a rat in my cell last night. Not too fun. They don't know what's going on with Paul. They get to hear this word, this letter that Paul has written, carried by Epaphroditus. They get to hear from Paul what he has been up to, what his situation is. And Paul, rather than, you know, he explains his situation, but primarily in the letter, he is encouraging the Philippian church. He writes with joy, though he is in a difficult situation, he writes to encourage the Philippian church. So imagine that, hearing from Paul. You know he's in jail. You know the situation is tough. But he writes this amazing, joyful letter of encouragement to the Philippian church, encouraging them, building them up. And just as we find salvation worked out in community, the gospel is lived and worked out in community. And the thing that I love about these two little discussions about Timothy and Epaphroditus, you know, that we kind of maybe overlook fairly easily, is that you think about Paul, you think about the great apostle Paul, this amazing, influential person, intelligent, brilliant, world traveler, preacher of the gospel, apostle, literally changed the world, had a huge part in changing the world of his time. But he didn't do ministry alone. And Timothy and Epaphroditus are just two examples of this. You find throughout Paul's letters names of people that he worked with, names of people that supported him, and the Philippian church. Paul values them because they partner with him. Paul didn't minister alone. And you see, even Apostle Paul, the great Apostle Paul, didn't do ministry alone. He had a team. There was people who were alongside of him, people that he relied on, people that supported him, people that helped him, people that he helped. So again, go back to our same theme, that salvation is lived and worked out in the community. We need other people. And when we look at someone like Paul, say, well, you know, Paul, he could do it all. He couldn't. He knew that he needed other people, and he relied on other people in the community as he did his role, and as they worked together, they were in partnership for the gospel, for the ministry of the gospel and salvation. And Paul's care for the church has led him to write back and forth, to build these relationships, to build these connections, to build these networks of people that he cared about, that together made up the body of Christ. So as we wrap up this morning, we're going to go into a time of communion. But I just want to say as we close, whether you're looking at salvation, whether you're enduring hardship, whether you're sharing the gospel, we do it together. It's something that happens together. We live in the community of believers. We work out our salvation in the community of believers. We share the gospel in community. We do it together, shining as lights for Jesus in a world that's looking for answers. We're going to turn to a time of communion this morning.
Part of what Paul says in the scripture that we're studying right now, it says, "But I will rejoice even if I lose my life, pouring it out like a liquid offering to God." Paul is demonstrating what Jesus did, and that's what we're doing as we gather around the tables of the Lord's Supper this morning. Is Nathan and Andrea, you guys need to come up and get ready. Paul is living out what Jesus demonstrated. Jesus poured out his life as a liquid offering when he was crucified on the cross. And every single time we gather together and we eat the bread and we drink the cup, we remember what Jesus did for us, the covenant he established between us and him, his death on the cross. I'm going to ask you, stand with us right now. We have three communion tables that you can partake from. I would just ask that as you come in and gather, if you're on the sides here, it's best if you come maybe down this aisle, pick it up here, and then go down the other aisle on the very edge so that there's a bit of a loop. Same thing over here. If you can come down here, grab your communion elements, then come around the edge. That would just help the flow of things. I also have some gluten-free crackers here, so if you need gluten-free to be able to participate this morning, we do have that. So why don't we start in worship, and you can come and receive your elements, hold them, and then we'll take them together.
Amazing love that welcomes me, the kindness of mercy that bought with blood wholeheartedly my soul undeserving.
Behold.
Read to you a scripture. It's actually from Isaiah 53. This is a prophetic word that was written hundreds of years before Jesus about the suffering servant, and it hits bang on exactly who Jesus was and what he did. In verse 3, it says this. It says, "He was despised and rejected, a man of sorrows, acquainted with deepest grief." You need to know, there are people here today, you need to know that Jesus is acquainted with deepest grief. You are going through grief today. And there's a God out there who's experienced the deepest grief that you could ever experience. He went through it. And it says, "We turned our backs on him and looked the other way. He was despised and we did not care. Yet, it was our weaknesses he carried. It was our sorrows that weighed him down." You need to know that Jesus died on the cross for your weaknesses, your sorrows, that he carries those. He's not a God that doesn't care. He's not a God that looks at you and just says, "Buck up, pull up your bootstraps, toughen up." He's a God that carries those things for you. He is there with you. He's there in your grief. He's there in your pain. He's there in your sorrow. It says, "We thought his troubles were a punishment from God, a punishment for his own sins. But he was pierced for our rebellion, crushed for our sins. He was beaten so we could be whole. He was whipped so we could be healed." All that happened to him for us. It wasn't because of his sin. He carried our sin for our rebellion. He was whipped so you could be healed. And then in verse 6, it says, "All of us like sheep have strayed away. We have left God's paths to follow our own. yet the Lord laid on him the sins of us all. I love in verse 6 how it says all of us. It's not some of us, it's all of us. All of us have strayed. We're all like sheep who've strayed away. We've followed our own paths. We've all done this. We're all in the same boat together. And yet, the Lord laid upon Jesus the sin of us all. And that's why we gather here together. We remember Jesus' broken body, how it was completely broken because of us, because of God's love for us. Let's take that together today, the bread. Cup of juice that you hold. It's not Jesus' physical blood, but it definitely reminds us of that, doesn't it, when you look at it? How his blood was poured out for us. It cleanses us, it purifies us. Let's take this together today. Why don't you stand with me? Why don't we finish that song together, reminding ourselves of who Jesus is, who God is through Jesus, and his death on the cross for us.
And should this life bring suffering, Lord, I will remember what Calvary has bought for me, both now and forever.
Let's sing it one more time.
And should this life bring suffering, Lord, I will.
Remember the goodness of God in your life. In the midst of the sorrow and the grief, may you know a God that is right there beside you. in the midst of you working out your salvation with fear and trembling, may you recognize that you are a part of the greater family of God, that we are walking this out together. You are not alone, but we do this in community. May you go, may you be blessed. If you would like to receive prayer this morning, I would invite you to come forward before you leave. I just feel that impressed on my heart that there are those that you need prayer this morning, and it's easy to walk out of here, but you need someone to stand with you. So I'd ask if you would, as we leave and as we dismiss, know that that is open to you, and I'd just ask if a couple members of the prayer team would come forward. Have an awesome Sunday. See you soon.